It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Chelsea Wood. Dr. Wood earned her bachelor's degree from Dartmouth, where she graduated with honors, and then went on to earn a PhD from Stanford University. After that, she held postdoc positions at the University of Michigan and the University of Colorado, and then accepted her current position as assistant professor at UW. A quick look at Dr. Wood's CV is quite impressive. She's got a really nice publication record, both in terms of quality and quantity, has been supported by NSF, Sea Grant, and a number of other sources. And what really struck me was the number of early career awards that she's already received and been recognized by. And this is because, at least in part, of the quality of her research program, which studies the ecology of parasites and pathogens. So thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Wood, and I will let you take it away.
Thanks, Chris. That was an incredibly kind and generous introduction. I appreciate it. And thank you to all of you for having me. As Chris mentioned, I'm Chelsea. I'm a parasite ecologist at the University of Washington. And I was so pleased to get this invitation and yet really bummed not to get the chance to come out to Florida and meet you all in person, especially because here in the Pacific Northwest, we're not only in month 11 of the pandemic, but also in what feels like the midst of a 5-month long rainstorm, which just let up today. I could use some sun, but hopefully we'll all get a chance to cross paths in real life at some point soon. Now, I know that everyone watching right now is mega zoomed out, so I wanna make this talk as fun as possible for you. I'm gonna show you my vision for the future of marine disease. It's gonna involve looking to the past. Along the way, I'll show you some recently published and some unpublished data, and I'm going to throw in just a little bit of Spielbergian magic. Today, I'm going to tell you about data that came from a huge field and lab effort. So I want to make sure that you know up front that I didn't do this all alone. This work is the result of joint efforts with lots of collaborators, Scripps, Stanford, WDFW, UC Santa Barbara, and of course, UW. And it wouldn't have been possible without the generous support of lots of funding agencies. One of my all-time favorite movies is Steven Spielberg's 1993 Jurassic Park, which just had its 25th anniversary. One of the things that I love about this movie is the way that it shows you what it feels like to be a scientist who studies the past. You make the inferences that you can make with the scraps of information that are left to you in the present day, but you really long to see those past ecosystems with your own eyes. Let's set the scene. Dr. Alan Grant and Dr. Ellie Sattler are just entering Jurassic Park for the first time with no idea of what the park is or what it's meant to contain. They have these theories about dinosaur behavior, but they're just untestable theories based on biomechanics or on the behavior of the dinosaur's descendants, the modern day birds. They don't think that they'll ever have the chance to test these theories in real life because they don't think that they'll ever have the opportunity to observe dinosaur behavior in real life. And then these scientists find themselves transported through time. Their lives were spent studying the artifacts of this lost world, and then all of a sudden, that world is found again.
Dr. Grant, my dear Dr. Sattler, welcome to Jurassic Park.
Today, I'll show you my vision for the future of marine disease and how new approaches are allowing us to do what Drs. Grant and Sattler did. I'll tell you the story of how I went from using the behavior of modern day birds to make inferences about the behavior of dinosaurs to literally watching dinosaurs behave in real time. All metaphorically, of course. because you guys didn't bring me here to talk about dinosaurs, what I study is far more beautiful and far more dangerous. I'm interested in marine infectious diseases and the parasites that cause those diseases. And today I'll tell you the story of how I went from using the scraps of information that we can glean about the dynamics of marine infectious disease from contemporary ecosystems to literally watching parasite populations change through time. I'm going to begin with the theoretical background that motivates my work, and then going to really briefly walk you through our work in contemporary ecosystems, where we're using space for time substitution to try and understand how various human impacts change the abundance of marine parasites. But I want to spend the bulk of my time today talking to you about brand new unpublished efforts that take us from contemporary ecosystems deep into the past. And I'll wrap up by drawing some conclusions about what marine disease of the past has to teach us about marine disease of the future. Let's begin at the beginning. I started in on this line of research because there is one question that really animates my interest in marine biology, and it is, what did the oceans look like before people? The world's oceans are being remade by a growing human population. If you spend time on the water, you probably have some intuition that marine ecosystems look a lot different today than they did in the past. And that intuition isn't just nostalgia. There are hard data to suggest that the oceans have changed substantially in the past decades and that fishing is primarily to blame for this. One of the easiest ways to see how fishing reshapes fish communities is to think about what we considered a trophy fish just a generation ago. This is a set of pictures from a 2009 paper of Lauren McClenahan's. Lauren went into a public library in Key West, and she just stumbled across these old trophy photos taken of the same hanging board on the same wharf over the course of 60 years. These photos reflect and document the state of Key West's reefs over a long time period, and there are a number of patterns that we can pick out in these pictures. Over time, the fish become fewer, they become smaller, and their average trophic level declines. And this is just one particularly visual example, but of course we know that this is a global phenomenon. And historical work like Lauren's gives us a pretty good idea of what the oceans used to look like before these impacts accumulated. We have pretty decent data for many of the large charismatic species. But as many of you may be aware, my interest in fish actually goes one level deeper. Each fish here is an ecosystem in itself, and that internal ecosystem is typically concealed. But what if we could unveil it? What sorts of parasites would we see in this scene? Were there more parasites in an unfished ocean, or fewer, or maybe the same overall number, but a different mix of species? Now, some of you in the audience might be thinking to yourselves at this moment, so what? Who cares? We've got much bigger things to worry about, like the loss of all these beautiful, charismatic, large vertebrates. Why would we care about what's happening to parasites? Well, even if you don't care about parasites, they do have big impacts on the rest of biodiversity. And I want to give you just one example. This guy who's wiggling in the upper left-hand corner is an anisakid nematode, and it's occasionally passed to humans when they consume uncooked fish. I am not going to gross you out with the symptoms. Ask in the Q&A if you're curious. But take my word for it, it's not fun. And the same go for the effects of all of these parasites on all of their wildlife hosts. And because parasites can have these big impacts, if fishing does cause change in parasite abundance, that could end up being pretty important for these vertebrate animals that we care a lot about. So here we have this big unanswered question in marine biology. And one of the things that makes this question really interesting is that we can make reasonable hypotheses that predict very different outcomes. It's easy to imagine how fishing might either increase or decrease parasite abundance, depending on its effects on hosts. Here I'm going to use the same time series of day boat trophies in Key West. I'll layer on some dots that are going to represent fish parasites. And then this conceptual diagram is going to illustrate what's happening in the photos. Fishing pressure is increasing as we move through time and across the x-axis. Now, fishing doesn't reduce the density of every single fish species, right? Fishermen have preferences, and they prefer to go after the big, high trophic level species like sharks, which can be good news for the lower trophic level species that are eaten by sharks because they can experience compensatory increases in abundance in response to the loss of their predator. If that lower trophic level host is increasing in density, we might expect to see a matching increase in the abundance of its parasites. In the disease ecology literature, this would be called the dilution effect hypothesis. But it's also easy to imagine how we might see the exact opposite thing. And that's because hosts are both habitat and resources for their parasites. Parasites could become less abundant as fishing proceeds because fishing reduces fish density or size or the trophic complexity of fish assemblages, and all of that should reduce opportunities for parasites to be transmitted. We can call this the healthy ecosystems are rich in parasites hypothesis after a tree paper by Pete Hudson, Andy Dobson, and Kevin Lafferty. But of course, when I say the word parasite, I'm invoking this sprawling group of organisms who are diverse, taxonomically, morphologically, trophically. We shouldn't expect them all to do the same thing. And so we might expect a mixed response of parasite abundance to fishing. Here I've changed the colors of the dots just to indicate what line they correspond to in the conceptual diagram. And then this all begs one big and important question, which is how does fishing affect whole parasite assemblages? Which parasites win, consistent with the dilution effect? Are there any that lose, consistent with the healthy ecosystems are rich in parasites hypothesis? And can we use some information to predict those outcomes? Years ago, lacking the ability to peer back in time, my team set out to answer this question by using space for time substitution. And this is basically the approach where we find contemporary ecosystems that look the way that ecosystems looked in their pristine condition. And in that way, a pristine ecosystem that exists today stands in for a pristine ecosystem of the past. We worked in the Northern Line Islands. This archipelago contains both islands that are inhabited and fished, but also islands that are totally uninhabited and have never been fished in their history. This box is going to go around Hawaii. About 1,000 miles south of Hawaii are the Northern Line Islands. And this is a color code that I'll use throughout the talk. Blue is going to indicate unfished islands, and brown will indicate fished islands. And you can see that we've got 3 fished islands in the middle and 3 unfished islands on either end of this archipelago. So of course the archipelago spans a gradient in latitude and all the associated abiotic features that are going to go along with latitude. But because of that mixed distribution of fished and unfished islands, we can parse those latitudinally associated effects apart from the effect of fishing. Our fished islands are Tarena, Tabuaran, and Christmas. They're part of the Republic of Kiribati, and each is inhabited by between 1,000 and 8,000 e-Kiribati people, most of whom rely on subsistence fishing. And even though this is relatively light subsistence fishing pressure by a pretty small human population, we see really strong effects of fishing on the fish communities at these islands. Very, very few of the top predators that are favored by fishermen. Contrast that with our unfished islands. These are Jarvis, Kingman, and Palmyra. They're owned by the U.S., and they're part of the U.S. Pacific Remote Islands Marine National Monument. And that designation involves strict bans on fishing that are well enforced. And as a result, these islands are just teeming with sharks, jacks, snappers, groupers, whatever predator you like, you name it, it's out there. These islands serve as a window into the past. This is what most coral reef ecosystems used to look like. So these islands are a living laboratory for understanding how coral reef ecosystems used to function. We set out to understand how fishing drives change in parasite assemblages by conducting sampling across those 6 islands. The sampling was done on a research cruise that was conducted in the fall of 2010. It was led by my collaborator, Stuart Sandin, and his graduate student at the time, now a research associate, Brian Zaglinski. They sailed from Hawaii all the way down the Line Islands chain, and at each of those islands, they collected fish with pole spears. We focused on 7 host species, and those species were chosen to span a variety of trophic levels and body sizes so that we would maximize the taxonomic diversity of parasites that we would find in these fish. Ultimately, across these species, we dissected 945 fish. That was 7 host species and 6 islands. That gave us a total of 44 common parasite species, 75 if you count the rare species as well, and just shy of 1 million individual parasites. And that might sound like a lot of parasites to count, but it's actually a completely normal burden for fish in this part of the world. For each of those fish, we examined every organ individually for metazoan parasites. We didn't look for protozoa, viruses, or bacteria. And before we jump into the results, let me get you oriented to one panel of what will ultimately be a multi-panel plot. This one applies to Tinnitus marginatus, our bristle tooth. On the y-axis, you're going to find all of the parasite taxa associated with this particular host. For the parasite fanatics in the audience, the parasites are organized taxonomically, crustaceans, monogenes, trematodes, cestodes, nematodes, and acanthocephalins, and that's what the horizontal bars are meant to denote. On the x-axis, you're going to find a standardized regression coefficient for the effect of fishing, which is a coefficient that comes out of the generalized linear mixed model that you see described at the bottom of the slide. And basically all you need to know about this x-axis is that positive values on this axis indicate a positive response to fishing, or parasite taxa, where we found more individuals on fished than on unfished islands. And then negative values on this x-axis indicate a negative response to fishing, or parasite taxa, where we found more individuals on unfished than on fished islands. Because this is a standardized regression coefficient, anything greater than positive 2 or less than negative 2 is significant, and that's why those two areas are shaded. And then all the p-values that you see here have already been corrected for multiple comparisons. So with all that in mind, we can take a step back and see that what this plot is showing us is that there's a whole mixed bag of responses among these parasites. We've got a bunch of parasites in the middle that aren't having a systematic response to fishing pressure. They're equally abundant on the fished and the unfished islands. Then we've got three parasites that fall in that brown zone on the right, where they're more abundant on fished than on unfished islands, consistent with the dilution effect hypothesis. But then on the other side, in that blue zone, we've got three parasites that are actually more abundant on the unfished islands, consistent with the healthy ecosystems are rich in parasites hypothesis. If we zoom out and look at all seven host species, we see that the same pattern holds. It's a totally mixed bag with many parasites not responding, some responding positively, and some responding negatively. Now, the fact that there are such mixed responses from parasite species to parasite species is in and of itself a really interesting result. Dilution doesn't happen in the majority of cases, and in fact, we often see the very opposite of dilution, parasites disappearing as fishing pressure increases. This is sort of counterintuitive. We think of parasites as bad things, right? We assume that when we do bad things to the environment, more bad things will result. So shouldn't we see more parasites on the fished islands? Well, we do in some cases, but we actually see the opposite in other cases. And these data suggest that we can't expect a homogeneous response among parasites, and that's really interesting. Consistent with predictions from the disease ecology literature. So we could have stopped there. But we had some hypotheses about why there might be this kind of variation from parasite to parasite. We thought that it might be related to parasite traits. So let's start peeling back the layers of this onion. We sorted our parasites into two broad transmission strategies, directly transmitted and trophically transmitted. Directly transmitted parasites are passed from one host to another host of the same species, but trophically transmitted parasites use multiple hosts of different species. They're sometimes also called complex life cycle parasites. In the fish that we dissected, we found parasites in both of these groups, crustaceans and monogenes among the directly transmitted parasites, and nematodes, cestodes, trematodes, and acanthocephalins among the parasites. And we made some predictions based on these fundamental life history differences. We assumed that these parasites would be transmitted in a density-dependent manner, so that if hosts declined in abundance in the presence of fishing, parasite transmission would decrease and parasite abundance would decrease. But of course, we know that's not the only potential outcome for hosts in a fished environment. We could also see an increase in the density of hosts if, for example, fishing takes out the predator of the host and the host then gets to increase in abundance in response to release from predation pressure. If those hosts increase in density, their parasites could profit alongside them. And so our hypothesis was that the directly transmitted parasites would track their hosts. In contrast, trophically transmitted parasites are dependent on multiple host species for the completion of their life cycles. And to top it off, those life cycles often include exactly the high trophic level predators that fishermen tend to go after. And if you take out one link in the life cycle of that parasite, it's game over. Transmission stops. So we expected trophically transmitted parasites to be especially susceptible to the impacts of fishing on their hosts. To test these hypotheses, we wanted to take this analysis and turn it on its head. We wanted to group up these regression coefficients by parasite type and find out whether there were any patterns. Remember, this is a space for time substitution. We want to get some hints about what parasites would increase and which ones would decrease in an increasingly fished ocean. So to answer that question, we asked whether the mean regression coefficient within a bunch of different higher order parasite taxa differed significantly from zero, and we call that the mean effect size. In this plot, we broke down mean effect size within a bunch of different groups, crustaceans, monogenes, trematodes, cestodes, nematodes, and acanthocephalins. The directly transmitted parasites are up on the top, and the trophically transmitted parasites are down on the bottom. And just like before, brown is a positive response to fishing, and blue is a negative response to fishing. I'm going to plot these mean effect sizes with 95% confidence intervals. So anything that overlaps is not going to be significantly different. If we begin at the top, we see that the crustaceans and the monogenes both have significant positive responses to fishing. They're more abundant on the fished than on the unfished islands. And these are our only two groups of directly transmitted parasites. So when we combine them, we also get a significant positive response. Why might this be? We hypothesized that the directly transmitted parasites would track their hosts, and it turns out that is exactly what they're doing. Many of the fish species that we targeted in the study actually experienced increases in abundance on fished islands relative to unfished islands, and the parasites of those fish drive most of the positive response that you see here. That's what's going on up top with the directly transmitted parasites. If we move down to the trophically transmitted parasites, it's a different story. The cestodes and the nematodes each have significant negative responses to fishing. They're more abundant on the unfished than on the fished islands. And then we only found this one acanthocephalin species, so it wasn't included in the formal analysis, but I did want you to see that its regression coefficient is non-significantly negative. And so far, that's all consistent with our hypothesis that fishing should interrupt the life cycles of trophically transmitted parasites and cause them to decline in the presence of fishing. But the trematodes don't follow this pattern. Their response to fishing doesn't differ significantly from zero. So that's a little bit of a departure from our hypothesis and from the findings for the rest of the trophically transmitted parasites. And we'll talk in just a couple of seconds about why I think that might be. But if we average over all of the trophically transmitted parasites, we see that their response doesn't differ significantly from zero, but it is significantly less positive than the response of the directly transmitted parasites. Okay, what's going on with the trematodes? I think it has something to do with their life cycles. The life cycles of the cestodes, nematodes, and acanthocephalins are fundamentally different from the life cycles of the trematodes. If you're lucky enough to come back in your next life as a cestode or a nematode, you're going to be born in the intestine of a large predatory vertebrate. You'll be pooped out into the water column, where you'll hatch and infect a first intermediate host crustacean, like the copepod that's shown on this life cycle. The trematodes differ a little bit. They also use large predatory vertebrates as their final hosts, although they tend not to use elasmobranchs, they prefer teleosts. And their first intermediate hosts are benthic snails. Now, planktonic crustaceans are pretty insensitive to fishing impacts, right? Their abundance is determined by bottom-up forces like oceanic productivity. Fishing doesn't affect their abundance, so when a nematode, tapeworm, or acanthocephalin life cycle is hit by fishing, the effect is straightforward. You just remove the final host, shut down transmission of the parasite. On the other hand, the effects of fishing on trematodes are more complicated because while the final hosts of trematodes certainly could be fished, there's different effects of fishing on different parts of the life cycle. And that's because snails are major prey of fished species. And we know from studies on Kenyan coral reefs that they can sometimes undergo big increases in abundance where they escape their predators. So it's possible that trematodes are getting these counteractive effects. Reductions in transmission due to fishing-driven loss of the final host, but then increases in transmission due to fishing-driven indirect increases in the abundance of the first intermediate host. And if you think about it, this actually begs a really important question in parasite ecology, which is, this is a cycle. Where is the rate-limiting step in that cycle? I don't know the answer to that, but I do want to give you some insight into why I offer this explanation for the equivocal response of the trematodes. And it has to do with this one weird outlier trematode. Stephanostomum is a trematode metasercaria that we actually detected in 5 different host species. And like I said before, trematodes usually use snails as their first intermediate hosts, but Stephanostomum uses a very particular type of snail, big, meaty moon snails and whelks, the snack food of the coral reef. So while Stephanostomum's definitive host, its final host, could be fished, it might be experiencing a strong increase in the abundance of its first intermediate host, which could explain why it has such a positive response to fishing and why it drives the trematodes in that positive direction. But if we consider only those trophically transmitted parasites that lack snail intermediate hosts, they do have a significantly negative response to fishing pressure. And altogether, these data show that there are both winners and losers among parasites exposed to fishing pressure. In our system, the losers include the trophically transmitted parasites, especially the cestodes and the nematodes, and the winners are directly transmitted parasites of hosts that increase with fishing, like the monogenes and the crustaceans, and also those trematodes that have intermediate hosts that increase with fishing. Now, we were really excited by this finding because it suggests that the oceans could have looked really different in the past than they do today. Not necessarily that there were more or fewer parasites in the past, but a different mix of species, a shift in the kinds of parasites that are common. Now, I could go on for another 2 hours giving you all the evidence that we've amassed to suggest that this pattern holds up in other ecosystems. And if you're interested in seeing those data, just let me know and I'm happy to share those papers with you. But suffice it to say for now, we've done additional studies ourselves and we've meta-analyzed the studies of others, and this pattern appears to be robust across many marine ecosystems. So we find these robust patterns of increases in directly transmitted parasites and declines in trophically transmitted parasites in response to fishing, and that's all well and good. But this was a space for time substitution. Contemporary ecosystems are not a perfect stand-in for historical ecosystems. They're kind of like this.
Welcome to Jurassic Park.
Wait for it. Not the real thing. What I mean to say here is that contemporary ecosystems are a pale imitation of historical ecosystems. And if we really want to know how parasite assemblages have changed over time, we need to find some way to get data on parasites of the past. We wanted to take our hypotheses that we developed in coral reef ecosystems and see if they could predict how parasites have actually changed as they've experienced mounting fishing pressure through time. And so let us now step through the gates of Jurassic Park, literally stepping back in time. People have come up with some really creative ways to glean information about historical assemblages of fishes. Some have used art, like this Roman mosaic showing a dusky grouper, a species that's now endangered and very rare in the Mediterranean. Others have used the composition of species represented in seafood menus to learn about change in fish assemblages over time. And of course, people like to take pictures of the big fish that they catch. And creative folks like Lauren McClenahan have extracted from those photos qualitative and sometimes even quantitative data to contrast against modern fish assemblages. And you guys have seen these pictures before. They're really striking. They bring home the fact that the oceans look very different today than they did even just a couple of decades ago. Now, parasites are just not that charismatic. No one takes pictures of them while they're on vacation. You won't find them on a menu, and not many works of art are devoted to them. And so historical information on parasite assemblages is harder to come by, except for one source, museum specimens. When fish or invertebrates are preserved in ethanol or formalin, their parasites are preserved right alongside them. And we're really lucky at UW to be home of the Burke Museum and its ichthyology collection, which is the largest collection of North American fishes with 11 million cataloged specimens and some collections dating to the early 1900s. And that sets us up to be able to reconstruct historical parasite assemblages across a broad sweep of time. I'm going to return to the Burke in just a couple of minutes, but first I want to set the scene for this next project that I want to tell you about. So I'm not originally from Seattle, but I've been here for 5 years now, and I like to think of it as my adopted hometown. Seattle is, of course, a fishing town, and it has been for a long time. Today it's the home port of the North Pacific Fishing Fleet, and that fleet ranges over thousands and thousands of miles of open ocean. But in earlier days, boats that were based in Seattle focused primarily on Puget Sound. Here's Puget Sound, located in the US Pacific Northwest. Those white dots represent the contemporary density of humans across the landscape, and Seattle is down in the lower right-hand corner. Today, not a lot of ground fishing happens in the US part of the Sound, but for much of its history, trawling was the most important part of Washington State's fishing industry, and one of the biggest earners were English sole, which produced these lovely, mildly flavored fillets. So this is a parasite talk, which means that you already know that if I show you an appetizing slide, it's going to be immediately followed by an unappetizing one. Around the 1930s, folks started complaining about these horrific things showing up in their sole fillets. And by the 1940s, infections were bad enough that tons of English sole landed in Seattle actually had to be diverted to animal feed because they were too wormy for human consumption. This magnificent creature is Clavinema mariae. It's a nematode bloodworm parasite closely related to a parasite that humans get called guinea worm, which I had the pleasure of talking to a bunch of USF grad students about just about an hour ago. The brand new Department of Fish and Wildlife, they kind of kicked into gear, they did their thing, they commissioned a research cruise to investigate the distribution of this parasite, hoping to find a part of Puget Sound that could still be profitably exploited. So they contracted with the RV Panther, and that ship went out in 1949 and 1951. They collected reams and reams of data on the abundance of Clavinema mariae in English sole. But they failed. There was no part of southern Puget Sound that was free of this parasite. The data got filed into a cardboard box. It was literally dumped into the basement of WDFW headquarters in Olympia. And when I first started at UW 4 years ago, a WDFW scientist named Greg Lippert heard through the grapevine that there was some weird parasite lady who just started at UW and wanted old parasite data sets. He had found it rooting around in that basement. I'd been searching for years, literally years, for good historical data documenting marine parasite abundance for any parasite in any ocean at any historical time point. These data are exceedingly rare, and so this data set fell into my lap like a gift from God. Another gift from God arrived shortly after. Ingrid Howard, an amazing undergraduate who graduated from our program a couple years ago. All the data that I'm about to show you come from Ingrid's capstone or undergraduate honors thesis project, which was recently published in the Journal of Applied Ecology. And if you're interested, I encourage you to check out the details in Ingrid's paper. We began just by looking at the historical data that were available. We entered all of the data from the WDFW commissioned Panther cruises in 1949 and 1951. Because this is an economically important parasite, we were also able to gather from some literature resources as well. And we then recreated all of these historical sampling efforts in 2017, sampling the same locations at the same depths using the same gear. Here on the x-axis, I'm going to show you five locations where we were able to obtain historical and contemporary data both. On the y-axis, you're going to find the prevalence of the parasite Clavinema mariae. For every site, historical prevalence was lower than contemporary prevalence, and on average, prevalence was almost 50% lower in the past than it was in the contemporary time. Now that's super interesting, and we were excited by this, but of course, this is one of those rare economically important parasites where we actually can find historical data. I'm curious about all the parasites, not just the ones that we happen to have data sets in hand for. We wanted to see whether we would get the same story if we looked to the museum specimens, and this would serve a couple of purposes. First, it would let us confirm this really interesting temporal pattern because we'd be testing for that pattern with two completely orthogonal data sets. If we got the same story, it would bode really well for all those other parasites for which we have no historical data to use for ground truthing. This is kind of like a proof of concept. We're asking, do historical data and museum specimens agree? Do you get the same answer when you dissect a museum specimen that you get when you actually go out and measure the parasite in nature? Because after all, the museum specimens could be a biased subsample of what was there in nature at that time. But if the historical data and the museum specimens tell the same story, that means that they might be a reliable way to reconstruct parasite assemblages of the past, and we might be able to use museum specimens to reconstruct change over time for those parasites where there is no historical record. So Ingrid set out into the UW ichthyology collection, and she pulled every single English sole that were originally collected from Puget Sound. She counted the number of Clavinema mariae in each of those fish, and here's what her data looked like. Each fish had on average 0.1 worms at the beginning of the data set and 0.8 worms at the end of the data set, a nearly eightfold increase in burden. So we get the same story whether we look at the historical record or the museum specimens, and it's a story of increasing parasite abundance over time. But of course, it's the story of only one parasite in one host, and we want to be able to tell a much grander tale across many parasite species. So I launched a new project that my lab likes to call Parasites of the Past. The project is supported by the UW Innovation Imperative and the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, and it's being carried out in collaboration with Luke Tornabene, who's the curator of fishes at the Burke Museum, and Catherine Maslenikov, who is its collections manager. We're expanding to look at the parasites in museum specimens of 10 Puget Sound fish species. And these species were, again, chosen to span a variety of trophic levels and body sizes so that we would maximize the diversity of parasites that we would find in them. Most of them are available at the UW Fish Collection, although we'll be supplementing from other collections as well. And we think that we should be able to get back into the 1880s for most of these species. So in Ingrid's project, we looked in English Soil. We saw that this one parasite just exploded in abundance over time. And we wanted to know, would that be the story of all the parasites in all of these fish species? I cannot answer that question for you now, but I do want to show you some of our preliminary data. We wanted to know, do the predictions that we generated in our work on contemporary coral reefs jive with how parasite assemblages have actually changed over time? But we need to first answer a separate and equally important question, which is, are the museum specimens that we're using even reliable? Can we count on them for accurate information about how many parasites were in a fish at the time of its death? Ingrid's study showed us that we get the same direction and magnitude of change over time, whether we look at the museum specimens or the historical data, but it's still possible that the museum specimens just make it harder to find parasites, and they could consistently underestimate parasite abundance, which would be a problem. Now, museums preserve their fish by first fixing them in formalin and then storing them in ethanol, and if that changes the detectability of the parasites, it could bias our estimates of their abundance. So to address this question, we ran a simple experiment, and when I say we, I mean my master's student, Evan Fiorenza. Evan got a hold of a bunch of fish, and he randomly assigned them to either be preserved with the museum's preservation protocol, or they were put in a control group where nothing was done to them. And then he performed parasitological dissections and looked for differences between the two treatments. And what Evan found was that there was a minimal influence of preservation on parasite detectability. He found 27 parasite species, and of these, only three differed between the control and preservation treatments. And of those three, some were more detectable in the control treatment, as we had expected, but some were actually more detectable in the preservation treatment. So among this tiny minority of parasites where there were differences between the two treatments, it was a mixed bag on whether it was easier to find them in the fixed fish or the unfixed fish. Now, Evan aggregated the response to preservation across those 27 parasite species, and he found that no group was easier to detect in one treatment than the other. Values to the right of this axis indicate parasites that were easier to detect in the preservation treatment, and on the left, easier to detect in the control treatment. There's no difference between the treatments when you look across all the parasites in gray, just larval versus just adult parasites in blue, or across the major taxonomic groupings of parasites in rainbow colors. Okay, so between Ingrid's study and Evan's, we can be pretty confident that the museum specimens are providing us with reliable information on parasite abundance. And with that in mind, we set out to answer our core research question, which is, how has parasite abundance changed over the past century? We've assembled a crack team to address this question: Rachel Wellicke, Whitney Presser, Katie Leslie, and Natalie Mastick. The work that I'm about to show you has been led by Rachel, and she's the first author on the resulting publication, which should be out any day now in Frontiers in Ecology and the Environment. Now, these guys are dissecting our 10 selected fish species, and these are literally parasite time capsules passed down to us from decades ago. We're just finishing the dissections for the project. We finished dissecting all of the hosts, but we go through this really rigorous data cleaning process where we check our taxonomic IDs with Mike Kinsella, who is retired, but graciously helping us with those identifications. They're a little bit more challenging in the museum specimens than they are in the fresh specimens, and we want to make sure that we get them right. So we've still got data cleaning ongoing for a bunch of species, but I can show you results from the very first host species that we've completed, which is English sole. So I'll begin these results by getting you oriented to one panel of what's going to be a multi-panel plot. What I'm going to show you are a bunch of time series spanning from about 1930 to 2016. On the x-axis will be year, and on the y, parasite abundance, and these are actually going to be partial residuals that adjust for differences in fish body size across time. I'll throw a regression line through each cloud of points with an associated 95% confidence interval. And then each plot that I show you is going to represent a single parasite species. I'll indicate to you the taxonomic group of the parasite with these cartoons. We'll have copepods and leeches among our directly transmitted parasites, and we'll have trematodes, nematodes, cestodes, and acanthocephalins among our trophically transmitted parasites. I've grouped up all these parasites by their responses, and there were 12 in total. Of the 12 parasite species that we detected, 9 of them did not change in abundance over the 85 years of our dataset. Notice here that there are a couple of directly transmitted parasites, leeches and copepods, also a number of trophically transmitted parasites. One of our 12 species increased in abundance over time. This is a trematode larva called a metasercaria that we detected far more of in recent years than in the deep past. And then 2 of our 12 species have actually declined over time. Here we have 1 acanthocephalin and 1 trematode, both trophically transmitted parasites. So again, we've got this mixed bag of responses with many parasites not responding, some increasing and some decreasing through time. But these are just the results for individual parasite species. What if we harness replication across those species and ask about trends for different parasite groups? Here are our results summarized across parasite groups. Positive values on this x-axis indicate parasite taxa that have increased through time. Negative values indicate parasite taxa that have declined through time. Neither directly transmitted nor trophically transmitted or complex life cycle parasites have a consistent direction of change in the aggregate. And the one place where we see a consistent effect is among the acanthocephala, a group of trophically transmitted parasites that declined through time. So this doesn't strictly match our prediction that directly transmitted parasites would increase through time while trophically transmitted parasites would decline. But we do see both responses. So I don't know, they're sort of moving in herds. I'm not nearly as prescient as Alan Grant, and we have a lot more work to do on this project. We've got 9 more host species coming up. It's perhaps the case that the patterns will become clearer as we increase replication at the level of parasite taxa, but our next step for these English sole parasites is to figure out why all this change is happening. We want to identify the factors associated with changes in parasite burden through time, because fishing isn't the only thing that's changing in this ecosystem. It's possible that the changes that we're observing are actually due to the steady incremental increases in sea surface temperature that we've observed in Puget Sound, which could speed up parasite life cycles. Or it may be due to change in the burden of nutrient pollution, which comes to Puget Sound thanks to development, agriculture, and logging. And those nutrients could facilitate blooms of the intermediate host copepods that are needed by a lot of these parasites to complete their life cycles. Or maybe it is due to the ebb and flow of hosts that's driven by fishing pressure. It's not the case that fishing has kind of increased in pressure linearly over time in Puget Sound. In fact, it increased linearly until the middle of the 1900s, at which point a lot of regulations went into place that really relaxed fishing pressure on Puget Sound fish species. And any one of these explanations is plausible, but which one actually correlates with change over time in parasite burdens? Well, we're actually really lucky in the system because these major drivers are pretty independent of one another. And because Puget Sound is a pretty well-studied region where we actually have these data in hand. There's a continuous record of sea surface temperature from Race Rocks Lighthouse in the Strait of Juan de Fuca. It runs from 1921 to the present day with just a brief break for World War II. There's a great study documenting biomarkers of nutrient pollution in sediment cores, which covers the period of 1880 to 2000. And then finally, there are historical fisheries data documenting the relative density of most of the hosts that we're excited about. And again, we're super lucky to be just steps from the people who are actually doing the science of reconstructing fish density. They include Tim Essington at my department, Jamil Samhori at the Northwest Fisheries Science Center, and Corey Green also at the Northwest Fisheries Science Center. We're working with these guys to chase down the potential drivers of parasite burden change through time. So while I can't answer that why question for you right now, rest assured that we're getting closer both to describing the patterns of parasite change through time and to narrowing in on some of the potential reasons for those changes. And before I close, I want to tell you very briefly about one of the ways in which we are narrowing in on those drivers of parasite change. This is a brand new project, one that I'm conducting in collaboration with Andres Lopez, who's the curator of fishes at the University of Alaska Fairbanks Museum of the North, as well as Stephen Bograd at the Southwest Fisheries Science Center. The project is just starting now. We literally, just in the past couple of weeks, got some pilot research funding from SECOS. Now, in Puget Sound, sea surface temperature warming has been pretty consistent across space. But in contrast, the Gulf of Alaska has experienced really divergent trajectories of warming across different regions. This is a figure from one of Stephen's papers in which he used reconstructed climate data going back to 1950 to show that the various regions of the Gulf of Alaska have warmed differently. Some of them, like the Southwest Gulf that you see in yellow, have experienced much slower warming than others, like the Queen Charlotte Islands in green or the Central Gulf in blue. We're going to take advantage of these divergent trajectories of warming to tease out the effect of climate on parasite burden. The Museum of the North contains fluid preserved fish specimens from all of these regions. And by comparing the trajectories of parasite change across those areas that are experiencing divergent trajectories of climate warming, we're going to be able to see how that warming is impacting parasite populations. So in that way, the Gulf of Alaska is going to serve as a natural experiment, giving us insight into the drivers of parasite change that we wouldn't be able to get in other regions. So this project is literally just starting up, and we're hoping to expand in the coming years, so please stay tuned. The past is past, and we now stand at this moment of unprecedented change for Earth's ecosystems. So what does all of this mean for the future of marine disease? What's going to go on under the surface of this visible world that's so familiar to all of us among these cryptic parasites that are typically unseen? Are we in for an explosion of marine disease, or is it the case that future oceans are going to see the loss of parasite species, even those species that contribute to ecosystem function? I can't say with a ton of certainty at this point which are the parasite taxa that are likely to increase through time and which are the ones that are likely to decline. But I do know that we are going to see both of those outcomes as we move into the future. We're going to lose some parasite species and we're going to gain others. And both of those outcomes have important implications for our ability to feed the world with seafood and to rely on functioning coastal zones for ecosystem services. And that's because the losers probably include lots of parasites with important roles to play. That might sound counterintuitive. We're used to thinking about parasites as bad, but they are natural parts of ecosystems and they perform vital ecosystem functions, especially the trophically transmitted parasites. We can talk about this till the cows come home if you want in the Q&A session, but to keep it brief for now, these parasites might keep host populations in check. They might lubricate vital predator-prey interactions, and they might actually be responsible for subsidizing apex predators. And losing these parasites could mean losing the ecosystem services that they provide. Meanwhile, the winners probably include parasites that we do not want around, pests of aquaculture and wildlife, and potentially pests of people. We have learned a lot from studying marine disease in contemporary ecosystems, but now that we have a way to get into Jurassic Park, I am not hopping on a helicopter and leaving. We have an opportunity here to resurrect long-dead information that most people thought was gone forever. And this information could help prepare us for a changing world. Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you, Chelsea, for that awesome talk, both in content as well as delivery.